Awesome. Good afternoon, everybody. How is everyone doing? Yeah, awesome. Everyone's doing good. Brilliant. Well, I'm going to be sharing the word of God with you all this morning. And I'm very... No, it's not morning. Sorry. I'm usually, obviously, only here in the mornings. But I'm going to be sharing the word of God with you this afternoon. And I'm really excited for what God's put on my heart. And I believe that it's a message for you guys, a message for myself and for you all. So I need you to do your best to stay awake, okay? No one closing their eyes, please. I really want you guys to stay awake, engage with me, and just open up your hearts for God to speak. Take this moment right now just to really be like, God, my heart's open, my ears are open to hear from you, to hear what you've got for me. And I really believe, and I'm praying as well, that God's going to speak into your life this morning. Afternoon, sorry, I'm going to stop talking about time before stop. So as I was preparing this message, I really believe that God gave me a message, and it's all about being chosen by God, chosen to be His. And I believe that I've shared before about my journey with God, and I remember when I came to Christ, and it was amazing, and I was passionate and on fire for God, but I remember that fire quickly dimming and kind of getting stuck in a rut with God, where I started coming to church on Sunday and that was good enough for me. I basically a Sunday Christian. I was happy and content with just coming to church on a Sunday and nothing else. And I'm sure maybe some of us have been there, that you get to a point in your life where you're like, I've kind of got to decide what I'm living for. I'm either going to be all in for God, all I'm going to go and do, or I'm going to go and do other stuff. And I got to that point in my life where I had to make a choice of whether I was going to be all in for God, a choice of whether I was going to stop just faking it, pretending that I loved God with all of my heart, when deep down I was just happy coming to church on a Sunday. And I realized that there had to be more. That there had to be more to Christianity. There had to be more to a relationship with God. There had to be more than just coming to church on a Sunday and thinking, yep, that was great, and then living my life my own way Monday to Saturday. And I believe that it got to a point in my life that I was like, God, I guess is what Pastor Andy's been talking about. I got to a point where I was like, God, I want to be all in for you. I want to be completely serving your purposes. I want to be actually spending time with you, not just on a Sunday morning. And I believe God was saying to me, and is saying to us this afternoon, you can't keep living this mediocre life. You were made for more. There is more to our relationship with God than just coming to church on a Sunday morning. There is more. And I'm assured in my heart, I'm 100% sure that Jesus Christ didn't just die for us so we could come to church on Sunday morning. There's more. There is more. And I kind of want to unpack that a little bit this afternoon. So in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9, it says, but you are the ones chosen by God, chosen for the high calling of priestly work, chosen to be a holy people, God's instruments to do his work and speak out for him, to tell others of the night and day difference he made for you, from nothing to something, from rejected to accepted. In another version, it says, but you are not like that. You're not the way you used to be. For you are a chosen people. You are royal priests, a holy nation, God's very own possession. As a result, you can show others the goodness of God. For he called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. Once you had no identity as a people, but now you are God's people. Once you received no mercy, but now you have received God's mercy. And I really believe that someone needs to hear this afternoon. Our spirits really need to wake up, and you need to hear that you are chosen by God. You are chosen by God. I'm not speaking to the person next to you. I'm speaking to you. You are chosen by God. And when he took you out of darkness and brought you into his light, it's because he wanted you. God wants you. And sometimes we need to hold on to that truth. God, you chose me. With all of my flaws, you chose me. Even when I was far from you, you chose me. Even if I make a mistake tomorrow, even if I make a mistake in the future, regardless of what I've done in the past, God, you have chosen me. You have chosen me for a purpose and you've got plans for my life. There was a time in your life when you had no identity. But now, when you're part of the chosen, you are God's people. You've got an identity, and your identity is found in Jesus Christ. So what do we do with that truth? When we hear that we're chosen, what do we do with it? Do we stay content and just keep coming to church on a Sunday and being happy with that? Or do we let it shape our entire life? Do we let it shape our lives and shape our day-to-day? And I know I want to be someone who lets it shape my life. If the word is telling us that we are chosen, then I want to openly say to God, well, here I am, God. In Isaiah chapter 6, verse 8, it says, "Then I heard the Lord asking, 'Whom should I send as a messenger to this people? Who will go for us?' I said, 'Here I am, send me.'" In 1 Samuel chapter 3, verse 4, it says, "Then the Lord called Samuel, and Samuel answered, 'Here I am.'" Chosen people open their lives to God. Many of the people of God in the Bible let go of their agenda and they took on God's agenda. They opened their lives for God, for him to do what he saw fit. And I've got a question for you guys. Is your life open to God? Is your life open to God for him to do what he wants to do with your life? Or are you on the run? Are you running away from everything he has called you to do? In Jonah chapter 1, verse 1 to 3, most of you have heard the story of Jonah before, and it's a great story, and I'd encourage you guys all to read it in your own time. But I'm just going to read a snippet of it, and it's found in Jonah chapter 1, and it's from verses 1 to 3. And it says, "The Lord gave this message to Jonah, son of Amittai. 'Get up and go to the great city of Nineveh. Announce my judgment against it, because I have seen how wicked its people are.' But Jonah got up and went in the opposite direction to get away from the Lord. He went down to the port of Joppa, where he found a ship leaving for Tarshish. He bought a ticket and went on board, hoping to escape from the Lord by sailing to Tarshish." Whenever I read this account, I'm like, Jonah, what are you doing? Like, come on. Who runs away from God? Who runs away from God? You know you're called Jonah. You know you're chosen. You've heard a word so clearly from the Lord. Yet why are you running away? But I'm sure Jonah's not he's not alone. I'm sure he's got good company, because I'm sure many of us do the same thing, that God's called us to things. God's told us that we're chosen, but we still live like we're not. God tells us that we're worthy, but we still live like we're not. And I believe that God's saying to us that I want you to stop running. I want you to stop running away from me and start running to me. I want you to start running to the purposes and plans that I have for your life. All of us have a plan for our lives, right? I'm sure I'm not the only one who often, especially in the new year, January the 1st, writes down some New Year's resolutions and plans and purposes that I feel like I want to achieve, or maybe sometimes I feel like God has for me. So we all have a plan for our life. God also has a plan for your life. And my question to you is, are they the same? The plans you have for your life, are they the same plans that God has for you? The Bible says that many are the plans in a person's heart, but it's the Lord's purpose that prevails. When we open up our lives to God, we agree to get involved in His agenda. Chosen people are God's instruments, used by God to give Him glory. And I'm sure I'm not the only one, but has God ever asked you to do something you don't want to? I feel like I'm, okay, a few hands are going up. Good. Okay, there's more of us, great. God has asked me many a time to do things that I don't want to do. And to cut a long story short, God always wins. I always end up like, okay, God, you were right. Okay, God, it makes sense. And I always end up following God's purposes, and that's all by the grace of God, and I'm learning to obey a lot quicker. Sometimes it takes about a year for me to finally give in. Sometimes it's a lot quicker, but I'm getting there. And most of you are aware that I have 3 children. I have a 4-year-old, a 2-year-old, and a 6-month-old baby boy. And I absolutely love it, but if there's any of you here who are often thinking that you've got nothing to pray about, your prayers are very welcome. Please pray for me. I will take it on board as much as possible. As I said, I've got 3 kids and it's amazing, but I need your prayers, people, okay? And as I said, I'm at a point in my life where we're in our household, we're going through that daily battle of wills. On a daily basis it is. And my 2-year-old is currently going through this stage where you might ask her to do something, maybe something simple like, hey, we're gonna go out now, can you put your shoes on? And often the reply I get is, no thanks. And you know, take a deep breath and I'm like, I'm gonna try again. Sweetheart, remember you want to go out. And if we're going to go out, you're going to need to put your shoes on. And once again, I just hear, no thanks. And I'm learning. And she's also learning. But the reason why I'm sharing this is because I think often, just like with my daughter, I'm asking her to do something because actually I've got her best interests at heart. I'm asking her to put on her shoes because I know that she goes out with no shoes on, her feet are going to get cold, she might step on something and hurt herself, and it's going to end in tears. So the easiest option is to believe that I know best and I'm telling you this for your sake. And I believe it was probably a little bit the same with Jonah and God. God was saying, Jonah, look, I'm asking you to go to Nineveh. If you obey me, you're not going to end up on a boat, end up in the water, and get eaten by a fish. But I'm sure that as God asked Jonah, he was like, no thanks, and went in the opposite direction. God's plans and purposes are best for us. They might be uncomfortable, but as a people that are chosen, when we open up our lives to God, He uses us for His glory. Most of you are aware how the story ended with Jonah. He ends up finally listening to what God said, and he goes and preaches the gospel to the people of Nineveh. But it was a long journey for him, but he finally got there. And you know what? God's not a dictator. He wasn't telling Jonah to do this and saying, you must do this. But he knew that, Jonah, I've got plans and purposes for your life that you might not understand right now. But if you walk in obedience and do what I've asked you to do, on the other side of it, people are going to know me. People are going to experience forgiveness and freedom and the mercy of God. But Jonah didn't want to listen. In Matthew chapter 16, verse 24 to 26, it says, what good is it to gain the whole world but lose our soul? And I want to say, what good is it to gain all of the purposes we have for our life, to do everything that we want to do, but lose our soul, but miss out on the very things that God has for us? God's got good plans for us. And you might be here this afternoon thinking, but it's too late for me. I'm a bit like Jonah. God spoke to me, He asked me to do something, I've walked in disobedience and I walked away from God. And I want to encourage you, it is never too late to come back to God. It doesn't matter what you've done, it is not too late. You can come back to God. The Bible also says that a righteous man falleth 7 times, but he gets back up. And maybe that's what you need to hear this afternoon, that you may fall, but you need to get back up. It doesn't matter how many times you fall. You might say, but it's the 8th time. The Bible only says 7. But let me say something to you. While there's still breath in your body, God can do something. God can do something. Get back up again. Get back into line with the purposes and plans that God has for you, because you are chosen for this generation. There is a call on your life that only you can do. And God's asking you, will you join in? Will you come on board and stop caring about the things of the world and start caring about my work? Start caring about my purposes that I have for you. There are plans that God has for you that he wants you to fulfill. And I want to encourage you, don't let fear get in the way. Don't let other people's opinions get in the way. Just walk out in what God has for you. Whatever he has asked you to do, he will give you the strength and the grace to do it. Pick up the dreams maybe that you have put down and believe God again. One of the biggest things that stop people from walking in their calling is the opinions of other people. And if we are not careful, the opinions of other people, which are usually in our heads, right? It's usually not real. We think everyone thinks something about us and it's not the case. But if we're not careful and we hold on to the opinions of other people, it will rob us of the incredible things that God has for our life. We live in a day and age now where there's a lot of media, there's a lot of social media as well, where everyone has an opinion, right? But may I encourage you, only one opinion matters, and that is the Lord's. There have been things that may have been said about you, labels that may have been put on you, that are restricting you from doing what God's called you to do. Things that are holding you back from walking in the purposes and plans that God has for your life. And if you're ever going to do anything for the kingdom of God, so I'm not talking to anyone here this afternoon who's just like, yeah, I'm happy with my life. I'm talking to the people who believe that God's called them to change a nation. To the people who believe that God's called them for something more, who's called them to make a difference in society. And if you're ever going to do anything for the kingdom of God, you're going to have to get over the opinions of other people. You're going to have to get over what people may think about you. You've got to take those thoughts to God and see what he says. God, they said I can't speak, but what do you say? God, they said I'd never be a singer, but what do you say, God? Because I want to live out what you say about me. I don't want to be what the world thinks I should be. I want to be what you've called me to be. So we need God's voice to be louder, right? We need God's voice to be louder than the opinions of other people. And we need to get to a point, and it's hard. I'm not going to pretend it's easy. It's hard sometimes. Whether you're in school or uni or college where it's peer pressure, or even in work where there's peer pressure, where there's the pressures of what people think about you. And sometimes you just want to be like, I'm not who you think I am. But God's voice needs to be louder in your life. You need to know who God's called you to be. Chosen people, people like us here, open up their lives to God. Often when we think about being chosen, it's a big thing. Everyone knows you. You might get a round of applause and it's like, wow, you've been chosen. Congratulations. Hip, hip, hooray. You've been chosen for great things. But in the kingdom of God, it's different. In the kingdom of God, we don't seek the approval of man. We seek God's applause. Chosen people find themselves humbly back at the feet of Jesus again and again. And I'm going to read an account with you, and it's about two women in the Bible called Mary and Martha, and it's found in Luke chapter 10. As Jesus and the disciples continued on their way to Jerusalem, they came to a certain village where a woman named Martha welcomed him into her home. Her sister Mary sat at the Lord's feet, listening to what he taught. But Martha was distracted by the big dinner she was preparing. She came to Jesus and said, "Lord, doesn't it seem unfair to you that my sister just sits here while I do all the work? Tell her to come and help me." But the Lord said to her, "My dear Martha, you are worried and upset over all these details. There is only one thing worth being concerned about. Mary has discovered it, and it will not be taken away from her." There is only one thing that's worth being concerned about, and that's about being at the feet of Jesus. And if I'm 100% honest with myself, the times I've found myself discontent, the times I've found myself struggling, the times I've found myself in a rut, as I spoke about a little bit earlier, when I've just been like, "God, am I for you or am I not?" It was often the times when I kept myself so busy and never spent any time with the Lord. And it's times where we can be running around and we're frustrated about so many things. And God is saying to us, "If you'd only just come and sit at my feet, if you'd only just spend a little bit of time with me, I could take those frustrations away in a moment." God's calling us to be people that spend time with him, that humbly keep going back to his feet to hear from him. And when people encourage you to spend time with Jesus, when we encourage you to attend our prayer meetings, when we encourage you to just be all in for God, it's not because we want, there's a, like a brownie point system and you're going to get brownie points if you spend time with Jesus. You're going to get brownie points if you read time, spent time with God in the morning. It's not about that. It's about the fact that time with God changes you. There's something about being at the feet of Jesus. There's something about spending time with Jesus when you're frustrated, when you feel like you've got the world upon your shoulders. There's something about getting in the presence of God that will change your life. If you remember anything from this message, please remember that you've got to be at the feet of Jesus. You've got to live your life humbly going back to the feet of Jesus, desperate for a relationship with him, desperate to know him more. As you read his word and you set your mind on the things of God, all other things fade away. When you set your mind on the things of God, things fade away. And you know, Martha, she was actually a good woman. She wasn't doing the wrong thing by cooking and busying herself. Actually, according to her culture, back in those days and in many cultures today, she was doing the right thing. Mary should have been in the kitchen with Martha. In those days, women would always be in the kitchen and the men would be sitting down, listening to the teachings and listening to Jesus. But Mary decided that actually, right now, the cooking can wait. Right now, everything else can wait because I've just got to be at the feet of Jesus. I've just got to hear what he's got to say. And sometimes I wonder when I'm reading it, what was going on in Mary's life? What was going on in her life where she kind of had enough and thought, do you know what? I can't be caught up in the busyness of life right now. I need to be with Jesus. You might have every right to be frustrated like Martha. Martha had every right to be frustrated with Mary because Mary should have been somewhere else. But when she took it to Christ, he said to her that, "Martha, you're concerned about the wrong things." And there may be things going on in your world where you're frustrated, you're feeling angry, you've got loads going on in your world that you don't understand, and you're busy in your life, you're doing all the right things, but there's one thing you're missing, and that's being with Jesus. And I absolutely love love church, obviously. I absolutely love what we do for God. But may I encourage you guys, please don't get so caught up in serving God that you forget to spend time with Jesus. That you keep on serving, you keep on serving, you keep busying yourself, but you never ever take out any time to be with Jesus. Because what will happen is you will get burnt out. You will get to a point where you feel like you're in a rut of, I'm always doing this. I've got the world on my shoulders. If I don't get here at this time, nothing's going to happen. And God's saying to you, but if you come to me first, if you spend time with me first, then actually those things won't frustrate you. They'll be so much easier. You'll still be able to serve. But you'll be serving with a new perspective, with a perspective that's been with someone who has spent time with the Lord. Regardless of what our lives look like, we have to find ourselves at the feet of Jesus. Because on your knees is where God can fix you. On your knees is where God can restore you. On your knees is where God can give you strength for the day ahead, for the week ahead. Find time with God. One of the reasons why I'm so excited about Connect Groups is because it's given us all as a church an opportunity to spend intimate time with Jesus together. An opportunity to come away from the busyness of everything and to actually just get plugged in with other people into the Word of God, learning more of God, being able to support one another and hear what God has to say. We are chosen to be His, and there's something so precious about that. And just as we come to a close, I just want to remind you all that God wants to spend time with you. He's desperate to spend time with you. If you're going to be chosen by God, if you're going to walk in the purposes and the plans He has for you, if you're going to change a generation, if you're going to maybe even change your family, if you're going to change things in this world, you're going to firstly have to open your lives to Him. And then lastly, you're going to have to remember to sit at the feet of Jesus. Sit at His feet and let Him use you for your use you for His glory. You guys are chosen. I really believe someone needs to hear that. You're chosen by God. There's things in your world that God wants to do in your world. There's people in this world that He wants you to reach. And He's just asking, come on, come and be part of that chosen generation. Come and be part of the chosen people that stand for God, that stop caring about what other people think and start walking in the purposes and plans that He has. And I just want to give an opportunity this afternoon to see if there's anyone here who has never given their life to Jesus before. Or maybe you're coming back to God. And we know that Jesus died so we could be in relationship with God. As I said before, there's more to life. There's more to life. There's something so beautiful about knowing God. And I never knew how great and amazing a relationship with God could be. It's the most precious thing I've got. It's the most precious thing I got. I remember being at a point in my life where I got tired of being a religious Christian. Tired of being someone who just came to church, who just did the right things and said the right things. And I was like, God, there has to be more. Come on, if you've said I can really have a relationship with you, then I want it. If you said that you can actually speak to me, then I want to hear you speak to me, God. And as I made that commitment to be all in for God, as I made that commitment of, God, I want to be devoted to you. I'm finally ready to be all in for you. I watched God change my life. It wasn't something drastic, but I watched myself suddenly have a desire to be with Him. I watched my desires change, and I wanted God more than I wanted the things of this world. And there's people here today who maybe you've not made that decision yet to start a relationship with God. It's the best decision you ever make. And so I'm going to ask us all just to close our eyes and bow our heads. And I'm going to pray a prayer, and I'm just going to ask you all to repeat after me. And then if you've never given your life to Christ or you're coming back to God, you'll have a moment to, an opportunity to put your hands up. So, dear Father, I am sorry for the things I have done wrong in my life. I thank you for sending Jesus to pay the price for my sin. I believe that you forgive me and make me new. Thank you for loving me. Amen.